Good day and welcome back. We'll talk about standing wave. In this lesson, we'll learn about standing wave which produced by the principle of superposition. We'll learn about the equation and it's different with the progressive wave. First of all, let's do a quick through on the principle of superposition. We learn that when two waves are on top of each other, resultant displacement at that point is equal to the vector sum of displacement of both waves at that point. In SPM, we learn about wave interference, which is one of the applications of superposition. There are two types of superposition. One is the constructive superposition, which happens when two crests or two troughs run through each other. We can observe that the resultant amplitude is higher than the amplitude of both waves. Another is the destructive superposition, which happens between a crest and a trough. Amplitude of resultant wave is lower than the amplitude of both waves. So now, let's talk about standing wave whose wave profile does not propagate with time along the direction of wave propagation. Unlike progressive wave, the energy is not transferred between particles. Basically, it is produced by the principle of two progressive waves of the same amplitude and frequency which travel in the opposite direction. To understand better about the formation of standing wave, I have attached video link in the description below which I would recommend you to watch it. I also added a link which can simulate the formation of standing wave, so you can try it on your own to see how it is formed. We proceed to the derivation of standing wave equations. Based on what I've explained, it is formed by two progressive waves of same amplitude, same frequency, but different direction. So we can use the progressive wave equation. One is moving to the left, and another is moving to the right. Standing wave is the vector sum of two progressive waves, so we can add both the equation of Y1 and Y2 here. To simplify this equation, there could be different formula used in the book, but I personally like to do my own derivations. Let me show you how to do it. From the topic of trigonometry we have learned in SPM, we have the double angle formula of sine A plus B or sine A minus B. Next is to add both this equation, and we have sine of A plus B plus sine of A minus B equal to 2 sine A cos B. Compared to the equations, the A here will be the omega t, while B is the 2 pi x over lambda. So apply this formula that we have 2 sine a cos b. So we have 2a multiplied sine omega t cos 2 pi x over lambda. In the end, we can simplify the equations become a sine omega t, where a is the amplitude equal to 2a cos 2 pi x over lambda. So this is the equation of standing wave, which is quite different from the progressive wave. Now, let's do some interpretation on the equations. First of all, this is one of the examples of a standing wave. If you recall back the topic of wave interference, we have something called the nodes and the antinodes. Nodes are the points where we have zero amplitude, while antinodes have the maximum amplitude. So we have zero amplitude at the nodes, so just solve the equations like what you did in the topic of trigonometry, and you can obtain few possible values of x, which is equal to lambda over 4, 3 lambda over 4, and etc. for the nodes. While for antinodes, we have the amplitude is maximum, which is either positive or negative values. So repeat again the process, and we can find out the possible values of x for antinodes are 0, lambda over 2, lambda n, etc. Now, if you want to calculate the distance between two successive nodes or antinodes, what you should do is to determine the difference between the possible values of x. For example, in the case of nodes, you will take 3 lambda over 4 minus lambda over 4, which is equal to lambda over 2. We'll get the same value as well in the case for antinodes. The conclusion we can make here is that the distance between two successive nodes or antinodes is equal to half of the wavelength of progressive wave. And then, based on the equation of amplitude, we could see that it depends on the value of x. This reflects that each point on the wave vibrates with different amplitude, which you can observe in the simulation. Now, we shall also observe the variation of amplitude with time. From the derivation, we have the equations of y is equal to a sine omega t. We can plot the graph of displacement against time for better illustration. The points are going up and down, similar as progressive wave. Let us refer to a point of antinode. At the time of zero, it has zero amplitude. So now, please observe the animation carefully. At the time of 1/4 of period of the wave, it will go up the maximum amplitude and then go back to zero again after another 1/4 of period. It will go down to the maximum negative amplitude and return to zero again, and the process repeat. So I think this should be not difficult to imagine. Now, you just think about all the points are doing the same thing in the same phase. The only difference is that each of them may have different amplitude, unlike the progressive wave. To conclude about standing wave and progressive wave, I prepared a summary table on what we have learned up to this point. In progressive wave, we mainly learned about the crest and the trough, which can be used as reference to determine the wavelength. For standing wave, we use nodes and antinodes instead. Next, each point on the progressive wave may have phase difference, which we have already derived the equations. All the points on the progressive wave are vibrating with the same amplitude, which does not happen in standing wave. So you can read the table here on your own. If you have any questions, leave it in the comment section. So that's conclude my discussion today. Please do leave a like and subscribe to my channel. I will see you in my next video. Thank you.